I've got Zaf Karim with me in the studio today from Legendary Investments. Zaf, great to see you. Good morning.
Good to see you, Andrew. How are you?
Very well, thank you. Results for the year to the end of March out this week. Good growth here for you. Value of investments at the end of the period standing at just over £6 million.
£6 million. We started, and that was 7 years ago, and we had negative net assets and no investments. We've raised in that time through, you know, a couple of fundraisings in 6 years, three fundraisings, I think, about 3 million. With 3 million, we've run the company for 6-7 years, and we've made investments. And the investments now stand at 6.1 million or so.
6.2.
And we use the most conservative valuation policy that we are able to use to value those.
Well, just give us a quick recap on the strategy then. You sit in the middle of being a VC and an angel investor.
Yeah, so basically, when we set out to do this, we thought, look, the biggest returns are typically made before listings. So, you know, AIM investors in particular say, oh, you know, the pre-IPOs always go to the insiders kind of thing. We never get involved in them. So we thought, because Tom and I have had a lot of experience of this, we thought, oh, why don't we were making investments in private companies anyway. And I thought, why don't we do this for a listed platform? Because then that gives the public investor exposure to those investments. And typically what we invest in are near startup companies. So somebody comes to us with a business plan, has done nothing, we won't invest. But if they've got a business plan, done some stuff, then we'll look at them. And so an angel will, invest in, you know, very early stage, a startup. A VC, when you're far more mature, we're somewhere in the middle. To put this into context against our numbers, angels typically you get 1 in 100, right? VCs you get 1 in 15, right? We targeted about 1 in 25. We've had 5 out of 12, which have been right. We've made 12 investments over 8 years or so. We've taken 3 to listing. One's got a VC involved. We've turned 3 million to 6 million on a backward-looking valuation policy, which just takes account of transactions values, not milestones hit and a DCF looking forward. So turning, say, the last £500,000 we raised after the year end.
That was in
May or something.
In May, yeah.
So essentially with £2.5 million, we've gone to 6.1 or 6.2 million of net assets. And if you analyze that in detail, it's 5 investments going right out of 12 on the strategy where you'd expect 1 in 25, 1 in 30 to go right.
And you're pretty hands-on with these companies that you invest in. You're not just sending off the odd email and making one or two phone calls.
When we invest, we are what I call proactive. We get involved in the companies. We might sit on boards. We help the management. So we might put them in touch with people. We might help them negotiate things. We might help them set their strategy. It's not just a matter of calling them up every 6 months or something. Of course, as companies evolve, they need less or more of our help, depending on exactly what they're up to. So if you take Dunraven, for example. So Dunraven is headed by a very experienced and established ONG, oil and gas CEO. So they don't need much input from us. However, the fact that they're a private company and we've invested and we've made an announcement about them in terms of what they're doing, that's already attracted the kind of interest they need. And as they go through the phase towards getting listed, we'll be helpful in that as well, because just through the exposure that we give them. If you take IBS, a totally different company, which is a banking services platform out of New Zealand. We got involved in that because the person setting it up, I've known him for three years or so, wanted me involved in that because it would have been quite key in terms of the right personnel to set up a banking services platform and get the license. And so we've been fairly hands-on in terms of making sure, you know, the license is obtained. Giving out input where necessary. As that evolves, obviously, because I'm an ex-banker, my input from a consultancy standpoint or whatever, via Legendary, of course, will be more important than, say, in an ONG company. So it depends on exactly what we invest in, how hands-on we are or not. But without question, for every company, we increase their profile.
You mentioned one of these businesses getting a VC involved, that being virtual stock?
Yeah, so virtual stock is something we identified and invested in back in 2012. At a valuation of $2 million, they were quite a small company then with a couple of $100,000 of turnover. After our investment, 9 months after that, they got Tesco's on board. 9 months after that, they raised funding at a $25 million valuation. It was only at that point we marked up. So I go back to the valuation policy. We held them at $2 million, despite the fact they got Tesco's on board. It was only when another subsequent transaction occurred, we marked them up. And then from that point, they got more customers on board. They got Sainsbury's on board. They got National Health Service on board, etc. You'd expect us to mark the net assets up as a result, but we don't. We wait until the next transaction. And the last transaction was a VC which specializes in cloud and SaaS-based companies, and they invested at a valuation of $66 million. And subsequent to that, further money's gone in, giving a post-money valuation of $70 million. So our initial investment was at a valuation of $2 million. We're now sitting on a company which the last valuation on our conservative basis is $70 million. I guess that's reasonable.
But why do you take that approach when it comes to valuing these companies?
Well, I think there's a couple of things. The first is a lot of companies that do this, they do a DCF type forward-looking valuation basis. And so that's a director's valuation, and there's nothing wrong with that, but you know, you're essentially trying to predict the future. And that inherently has difficulties, you know, whether you're looking at you know, your proverbial glass ball, or you're doing lots of DD and research and everything else. We thought, you know, let's take the most conservative approach that we can, simply so that we avoid negative surprises. So something has to go wrong for us to mark down. If you project forward, you know, theoretically looking at it, something could go wrong, or your projections were wrong. With ours, something actually has to go wrong, because you're backward looking in terms of marking things. Take an example, IBS. IBS is a banking services platform. The key thing about any banking services platform is getting the license, and that's worth you know, a large amount, but is it worth £10 or is it worth £10 million? Who knows? The point is, when we Legendary obtained its stake in IBS at nominal value, because we were essential in the setup of IBS, and we held it at nominal value until investors got involved at a valuation of $10 million US, $14 million or thereabouts New Zealand, and then we marked it up. But it was subsequent to that it obtained its banking license. Now, there's many arguments as to that's increased the value, but we are not going to mark up until somebody else comes in and says, oh yeah, this is worth more. But we could easily try and put a value on that license and add it. But that's why I say, then you've got two things. You're projecting out into the future, and something could go wrong. With us, something has to go wrong. And our investments do go wrong. You know, look, we've made 12 investments. We've had 5 successes. We haven't had 12 successes, but that compares pretty well in the space we operate, where there's very large returns available for successful companies. When you compare 1 in 100 for angels, 1 in 15 for VCs, I mean, you know, it's pretty good.
As far as the outlook is, Zach, you talk about taking Legendary to the next stage of its development.
Yeah.
What's that involve? How does that look?
So basically, I think we've kept our heads down for, you know, 6-7 years. Worked hard on these companies, making the investments work. I think now we've proven our model, we have a track record, and you know, we want to strengthen the board, so we're in discussions with a number of candidates. That will give us more capacity, a wider network, a larger pool of skills. It's all about the people. Then we've taken a lot of soundings from various constituents, and you know, a lot of people have said to us that you know, we should consolidate, because at 0.1 pence the shares appear on this many radars. If they were 10 or 20 pence shares, they'd appear on this many radars. And then we're changing the name as well, because again, when we did our consultations, you know, some people still associate Legendary with the management prior to us, and that was, you know, almost a decade ago. So it's about having, so we had an idea, we've executed it, it's proved successful, so now we can scale up and hopefully make a quantum leap, you know, in the near future.
And this change of name to Eight Peaks, that'll be put to shareholders at the end of next month.
Yeah, so the change of name, the consolidation and the usual things at the AGM will be put to the shareholders at the end. Yeah, but we're hoping to have our AGM last week or thereabouts of September.
Zaf, great to see you this morning. Thanks for your time.
Thank you, Andrew.